How's it going, everybody? Bryan Elvers and Dave Meltzer here, Wrestling Observer Radio, September 23, 2021, figure4online.com/wrestlingobserver.com. We got a lot of news to get into today, including talking about one of the best televised matches ever, Kenny Omega and Bryan Danielson from the AEW show tonight. Holy smokes, 30-minute draw. It was awesome.
Yeah, it was one of the best TV matches. I think I can think of. I mean, it's up there with the biggest ones ever. I would say it was the best match on AEW television so far. The ones that I would say would be the best would be that straight fight with Santana and Ortiz against Best Friends, which is a completely different kind of match. You can't really even compare it, but it was awesome. And then the Kenny Omega Pac Iron Man match, which I think was better when it came to flashy moves, but I think this was a better all-around match than that one, very slightly. And the other one, I guess, would be the Britt Baker and Thunder Rosa match, which was dramatic and a bloodbath, but I think this was a better match than that one also. So I would say it's the best TV match in AEW history.
We also had Nick Jackson and Phoenix.
I thought it was better than Nick Jackson Phoenix.
That match was awesome, though.
Nick Jackson Phoenix was right up there with those, right. That one. And Matt Jackson Phoenix, too. But Nick Jackson Phoenix probably, Nick Jackson Phoenix was way up there, too. But I think this was the best one, in the best TV match in AEW history. And one of the best matches in company history. And, the other part of it, too, is it's very clear from watching this match that they were saving a lot of stuff. Because it's like, this isn't it. It can't be it. You know what I mean? They got to do a rematch. They really should be doing a rematch for the championship on the next pay-per-view, although I don't know that that's the case. But, it was a super pro wrestling match by two of the best pro wrestlers of this generation. The other thing about the match that was so great was it was like a Kento Miyahara match in the sense that, like, usually 30-minute draws. I mean, and I think a lot of people early on knew that they were going long. And I think that as it was going, I think people kind of figured it was going to be a 30-minute draw at a certain point. It had a lot of Flair Steamboat stuff, in it too. But it went so fast. It was like I'm watching this thing, and then all of a sudden I looked at my watch and it was 26 minutes in, and it's like, what? It's like they're going to a draw for sure, or they're going to do it like the Okada Tanahashi where they do a pin at like 29 minutes and 30 seconds. But it felt like we were maybe 15 minutes in. It was one of the quickest. Talk about not dragging. And I think they had a lot of help from the crowd, because like at the beginning, like they could stand there for 2 minutes almost without touching, because the crowd was so hot and they didn't have to rush anything, because everything they did, the crowd was going to, go crazy for. So that made the match feel so much faster than it was, but it was an awesome match.
So the Dynamite show opened up with Kenny Omega and Bryan Danielson. This was the opener, and as noted, they went to a 30-minute draw, and this match, like, Danielson had made the comment that, I'm back as a wrestler, and you're not really a wrestler in WWE. And he had some great matches in WWE, but I mean, this was Bryan Danielson from 12 years ago. I mean, just he had a cattle mutilation, he had capture suplexes, he took a dragon suplex off the top rope, which they never would have allowed him to do in WWE.
Well, he flipped over. He didn't like
he did
take
flip
it like
totally over. He didn't land on his head.
He didn't take it like Okada did against Omega, which was really a brutal move.
But it was a top rope dragon suplex. And yeah.
They did a lot of new stuff, like Kenny Omega doing that wind sprint V-trigger was pretty sensational.
Yeah, he did a wind sprint on the ramp and hit the V-trigger. Just so many great spots. Danielson did his knee off the post to the ramp. There was a spot where he got buckle bombed and he went over the top, and from that point forward he sold his wrist for the rest of the match, and I was told he was fine.
I was told he was fine too.
And that it was just fantastic selling, but I do know that when I first saw it, I thought this guy broke his wrist. And then I talked to people there, and they thought that he broke his wrist. But then it turned out he's just great at selling. So anyway, he was fantastic.
He's great at selling, but you know, you when he did that, when he was selling, I was thinking, you know, remember that Randy Orton match where I thought, on that one, I thought, man, he's great at selling, and he really was hurt bad. So, I mean, that's the one thing with, you know, that with Danielson now, that because when he was in WWE, they were very protective of him, you know, even though he isn't necessarily protective of himself. But now, I think that it's going to be kind of free reign. And I mean, his biggest obstacle may be like the injury aspect of everything, because, you know, he's got a lot of mileage on his body. Although, you know, right now, I mean, like he feels from what I understand, he feels great because he took all these months off and he looked in great shape coming back. So, you know, I mean, the one thing is when you rest up and come back, I mean, your body does heal, but if you've got those injuries, you know, after a while they can come back. The other good thing with him is that going forward is he's going to be working a lesser schedule. I mean, he talked about like he had a year in WWE where he did, I believe the number was 227 matches. And, you know, here, I don't know that he's going to do 30 matches in a year. I mean, you know, maybe, because the way they you know, cycle people in and out, and it's going to be like, you know, I mean, he'll probably be on the pay-per-view shows. He'll probably be on every pay-per-view show. And he'll probably be on most Dynamites and or Rampages, but he won't be necessarily wrestling on all of them. Maybe he'll do, you know, yeah, I'm going to think that, you know, maybe... Yeah, maybe 35 matches in a year, something like that. And then he'll probably do, you know, actually, it may be a little bit more because he'll you know, if Japan opens up, obviously he's going to do stuff there. He'll probably do some independent stuff like Moxley does in different places. So, but you know, it's not like it's even 100 matches. It's going to be the fewest matches that he's done when he has been active and is probably since, you know, he was 20 years old. So, that helps somewhat. But on the flip side, I think, like, when he does his big matches, I mean, they're going to be all out. You know, there's going to be a lot of those matches. I think that most of his matches, the actual matches that he does, are going to be, I don't want to say they're going to be like this one, because it was Kenny Omega, but I don't think they're going to be far off. I think they're going to be, you know, I think he's going to be like Kenny Omega and the Young Bucks and, you know, people like that, that go out there, that every single time they're out there, Moxley, I mean, it's like a very good to a classic match.
So they go to the 30-minute draw. The fans are furious. Allegedly in the building, there was a 5-minute call, like 5 minutes before the end of the match. We only heard the 1-minute call on television. Yeah, I did not hear a 5-minute call.
That's the only one that I remember.
So the crowd is just furious at the finish. So they send out the Young Bucks and Adam Cole, and they get massive heat. And they go after Danielson. They triple super kick him. And then Christian, Jurassic Express run out. They make the save. And that, of course, sets up the match on Friday. Very, very good opener here.
Super opener. They still may do that 8-man tag. I could see that. And the one thing that I was surprised a little bit is I thought tonight, somehow, somewhere, Adam Page was going to come back. And the fact that he didn't.
I don't think he's coming back till they go to his hometown.
To Roanoke,
or wherever they're going. They're going somewhere
Norfolk.
In Virginia.
They're going.
Right?
To, they're going. To, they're going to Norfolk. God, I think like mid-November.
Yeah, that's why I thought he was coming back.
Maybe he'll come back on the pay-per-view, because the pay-per-view is so the pay-per-view. It has not been announced for the Target Center, but the fact that Rampage the night before, that's so weird that they announced Rampage for the night before the pay-per-view in the Target Center, but have not announced that the pay-per-view is in the Target Center, even though I'm virtually certain that's where it's going to be. So, you know, I only heard the Twin Cities, but, you know, they're going to run it in the same place because it's a Saturday night pay-per-view. So they're going to run it the same place they run the Friday night Rampage show. So Minneapolis is it's an interesting market because their pay-per-views, when I got the market-by-market numbers, and that was, you know, granted, that's a year and a half ago and things could have changed somewhat. Minneapolis was not a good AEW market. And just last week, when I was doing the comparisons of SummerSlam and All Out, you know, SummerSlam was twice as big in Minneapolis as All Out, and nationally, All Out was actually slightly bigger. So, as far as general public interest, so it is a the indications are that this is going to be a tough market, and they're running, you know, target center for a show like this is 13,000. You know, so I mean, there's a lot of markets right now. I think that AEW on a pay per view is going to get 13,000 people, but I don't know Minneapolis being one of them. But you know, maybe they're so hot that they will. We'll see.
Hey, if you're a big fan of Wrestling Observer Radio, we got 12,000 episodes of all of our podcasts up at our website, WrestlingObserver.com. If you sign up today, you get access to every single one of them, the 12 to 18 new shows that we do every single week. You can podcast them, listen to them on the road, at work, working out, in the shower, wherever you listen to your podcasts, and also full access to the Wrestling Observer newsletter and archives. So if you love what you hear, head to WrestlingObserver.com. 12,000 audio shows at your fingertips.